That whole thing about being a movie star isn't part of my personality. What interests me is the character work. And what interests me about it is the aesthetics of being different people. What isn't interesting to me about it is how my hair is cut and what clothes I'm wearing. I can't care. I work hard, but I don't work out. I don't particularly diet. I worry about my face, you know, if my face is pretty, I do worry about that. But outside of that, the whole thing of, I can't explain it, the inflow, you know, the inflow about being a star, I just don't go for it. It just doesn't happen. I'm not interested, and it's not part of my life. The outflow of being an actor is every moment for me.
She really strives for authenticity, to play it right down to the bone.
I want to see Karen Black because I love her acting.
As a little boy, I had a very big crush on her.
Well, I'm a big fan of Five Easy Pieces. We rent that movie on a regular basis.
I liked her in Can She Bake a Cherry Pie?
I liked her in that crazy movie with that little guy who chased her around the house. The weird little teeth. Do you remember that one? And, Trilogy
of Terror. I thought she was great in that.
Ah, Day of the Locust. Or maybe The Great Gatsby.
Come back to the Five and Dime, Jimmy Dean.
Why is that?
Just everything about her, you know? Her eyes, her voice, everything.
I think she always does very interesting characters, so I'm curious to see what she's like now.
There was this fireplace, and this is a really cute story, and it's really true. And I stood up and I said, well, I like to go to Memphis, but I don't know the way. And I'd like to tell you how I feel, but I don't know what to say. And he said, you've got the part.
Martina's all over that.
Here we go. Last looking for picture, please.
Karen Black is walking in.
Don't walk into something now. See, I'm getting my accent on the way. My accent is from, she's from Cuba, Missouri, which is 40 miles north of Arkansas. And what I did was I called some people up in Missouri. They live 12 miles north of Arkansas. But, it's also a little bit Tennessee, and I talked to this lady, and she was very wonderful to me, and all of her relatives were very wonderful to me, and she kept passing me over to other people, telling me she didn't have an accent anymore because she'd lived in St. Louis for so long, and she says, you know, I don't really have an accent anymore. I mean, it's just gone. You know, I just don't have it anymore. But I'm sure Trudy has. Now, listen to Trudy. She's got it. And Trudy would go, now, liar, idiots. I'm talking it. Liar. God, I can't talk like that. It's like a rooster or something. Wah, 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 liar, you know. So I just had her say a lot of my lines. That comes a step. I had her say a lot of my lines, and I just wrote phonetically down everything she did in it. So I have her accent, and I feel pretty confident with it. Well, we're doing a scene where the little retarded girl wants to hug Trevor, who's the leading actor. And I'm his mother.
Roll sound.
Rolling.
And action.
An odd thing about the character in Dogtown is that you can tell she's wicked in a way because she does never let anyone finish their sentence.
She wants you to hug her, honey.
And they need very much, oftentimes,
okay,
to finish their sentence.
She's just like one of those little Reese's monkeys.
As all of us do. And in that sense, she prepares a bulwark, her own space, against
okay, honey,
any particular
enough.
Inflow, so that she can
that's
keep
enough.
Her fantasies. And that's wicked.
You have such fun while you're home. Let's go down to Blockbuster tomorrow and rent all them movies you've been in.
And cut. Very good. Let's move on.
I wanted to tell you about George, and I want to tell you about directors. Okay, what George does is he never loses an opportunity to enhance a person's self-respect. Never misses. You know, like, and I've had the strangest ideas in this movie, that he's just done them. He's going to correct you. He says, that was wonderful, but could you?
I think she's one of the finest actresses working in American film. Been a huge fan of her work since when I was a kid. I saw Five Easy Pieces, Day of the Locust, Nashville. I love her work, and she's a fine actress. And I even loved her in some bad movies like Airport 75, I think, and Trilogy of Terror, and Burnt Offerings, and Family Plot. And she's just one of the best actresses I've worked with.
It's kind of, I guess they call a low-budget picture, which means if you have an incredible amount of work to do, you do it in 4 days, 5 days. You know, you like, it's hard to explain. But when you're acting, I've read that it's like climbing a mountain. It takes a lot of, I don't think that's true, but I've read that it takes a lot of, you have to be right there, right on the money. You know, you have to like have all the feeling and all the character and all the, you know, remember all the words and everything. And you do that hours and hours a day, and until you're drained. I mean, it makes you want to do a blockbuster. So you're doing a blockbuster, you know that you're going to come and go. You know, you're going to a day, and then you'll wait a week. It's just draining. And I'm just telling you, I'm sleepwalking. I'm just sleepwalking.
What she does so well is she really captures the core character, and she finds the focus of the character, the soul of the character, and then she illustrates different aspects and facets of behavior from that core. And she really builds from the inside out, and everything she does, all the moments and nuances she does, are so real. And I find her just really compelling. And yesterday we did a very powerful, poignant scene, and she just studies the part. She's very well disciplined, and she's very focused, and she spent 20 minutes by herself really getting into this sort of melancholic state, and then it paid off wonderfully on the first take. And she's fine. I really love to work with her again. She's a great treasure.
And she starts into, well, everybody has their ups and downs, honey. Not enough time to really to scramble eggs. Not quite enough time, but it's close.
Mm-hmm.
So, if we had two identical pans or similar enough, you don't, do you?
I'll check.
Anyhow, then she could start scrambling the eggs.
Right.
You know, everyody has to look at John Travolta. Blah, 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 blah. John Travolta is linear.
If it works for me, if it works for you.
Yeah, and then she could, because I probably won't be done with the eggs. I need a bowl and like one of those things and toast and butter. And a toaster. Is there a toaster here?
Yes, there is.
Okay. Then I just take the pan that it has the eggs and put them on its plate.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm pretty sure that it won't heat up until, I'm pretty sure I can't quite get eggs scrambled. I do all the time. In those three lines.
Okay.
I make the best scrambled eggs and the best fried egg you've ever eaten in your life. I'll tell you exactly how
you do
it. Yes, I do. I love it.
Can we shoot one, George?
Sure.
I cannot believe she would not have a good sugar roll. What happened to her?
This is, I think, the first breakfast that her son has had with her. He's come home after some years.
Well, let's do a rehearsal now, please. Yeah, try it's early, and then Karen will say, did you want to sleep in?
Okay.
And then Beat, you had fun with your friends last night?
Okay. Need a Beat egg.
You like your little sign here? Happiness?
Yes, I do.
All right, good.
That's nice.
All right.
Under her robe?
Huh?
Under her robe?
Jesus is the reason for the seasons.
Oh, that's great. I need to see that.
Okay, I'll take it.
we want to have that.
Yeah, no, I'm going to serve him in a second.
Oh, excellent.
I'm going to give this to him.
Oh, that is excellent. All right, ready? And action.
Graphic, a John Travolta, the cover of National Geographic. Well, eat your eggs, honey. Don't get all...
Pretty good, Karen. You must have been
worse
than that.
Those are the grace I've ever seen.
Breaking for lunch. I'm not going to tell you again.
That's crazy, lady. Let loose out of the insane asylum.
And I said, oh, uh-huh. And I went for a walk up, and I went to my room. It's me. I want to mention to you that I am now without any makeup on at all, of any kind on my face except Vaseline, which you got to say is not makeup. I have no eyes. They're very tiny. And, you know, on a regular film that you don't see any. And I've had the most horrible problems in my life trying to give myself pretty eyes without making it look like I have too much makeup. But it takes shadowing and so forth. And people have said, oh, you've got to take all that shadow off. I've had John Schlesinger screaming at me, your eyes are little black pits, your eyes are little black pits, because there's no light in my eyes. I say, look, if you put light in my eyes, I have eyes. And you believe all the little lines I draw around them. But if you just simply, if you just do ordinary Cheryl Ladd lighting, who has a perfect face, I'm going to have little black. They're very close set. They're only this far apart. Look how close that they are. They're only this far apart. As big as my lips. And one of my eyes is as big as a third of my lips. So I've been, you know, it's like I draw and paint. So these are little paintings I do. Anyhow, such suffering I've had with people who, you know, don't want me to wear eye makeup and yet expect me to have eyes.
Now, since we're getting this set late today, I'm making up a brekkie. With low-fat mayonnaise, darling, and Dijonnaise mustard, and all these things. This is the posh, svelte life of the actor. Did I already put mustard in? Yes. This movie concerns Ada Lovelace, who is Lord and Lady Byron's daughter, in around 1830, 1833. And she actually first conceived of the computer. She was a mathematical genius, and she put together the notions and the notes and diagrams for a computer. I was hired to play Lady Byron, Ada's mother, and Lord Byron's wife. And today she's going to see the machine, which will eventually become a computer in the real world.
Looks very cold out.
Some of the machinery that this woman came up with is still extant. You go there and there it is, the same one. So this character sees it today in the film for the first time. And, you know, she thinks it's pretty but useless. Uh-huh. See there? What, those nice people? Pretty darling, but what good is it? The end.
You're going past Walgreens. Maybe I can go in and get my script. Or maybe not. It's just up there.
Your script?
Yes, I left my script in Walgreens. I just wish I had my script because I'm not really memorized.
Are you sure they have it there? We can swim by.
No. I'm trying to make everyone late.
I think we have time. It's 1:20. We have to pick.
We're supposed to be there at 1:20?
No, it's 1:20 right now. Oh, no, it's 12:20 right now.
Yeah.
And we have to get back on Venice, too.
The present time mom, all her little notes are there. It's nice to have. But I don't want to be late. I walked and walked and walked around looking for little places to buy my little girl presents. By the time I got to sit down to eat and start memorizing my lines, I was so depleted. I just thought, well, I'm not going to. I can't offer much spirit to the learning process here. I'll just look them over and learn them later. And you know what? I was wrong. I should have done it. Because that's a really good test of one's nature when you're really depleted and you're really exhausted and you just keep going. I think that life rewards you a lot for that. You have a green light, darling. One time I was trying to I had written this movie called Light in the Afternoon, and the producer who was also a distributor, he kept wanting to have blood, you know, and car chases and so forth. And I just, it had nothing to do with these very daffy, lighthearted people who kept exchanging partners in a house and all this. And finally, I learned that there was a whole, that he didn't want to go back to a certain location because it would cost, what, $5,000 or something. Sure. And we weren't done with the location in any way, shape, or form, and the movie would make no sense without that location. None. And so I remember I got up in the morning and I just called everyone and everyone's brother and everyone's sister and everyone's uncle and aunt and to try to get $5,000. And I'll never forget, I was so exhausted and enervated, and finally 10 o'clock at night I raised it.
Really?
Yeah. Wow. And we went and we shot it. So I think that I should have memorized those lines yesterday when I was so exhausted. And that's what you have to do. I think you have to push through those moments, and I think you have a lot of win. I think you win a lot when you do that. You know what I mean?
Not definitely.
Yeah.
That made me look more like that. So more like her at a time.
Well, she can't tie a tie.
Yeah, that's what you're asking.
Well, what is the costume? Or is it? I don't know these.
Okay.
It was Sundance. I was in the Institute. It was one of the screenwriter guys they had.
I was too.
Were you?
Yes.
You know Michelle Satter?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
I did that with the one they're going to make next spring called Deep Purple. Yeah.
Oh,
so I missed you. What year were you there?
I was there in 89.
Yeah.
And then I went 2 years ago to Equinox Film Festival, which is a part of the Sundance with my Bronte.
Wow. It's amazing, what an amazing whole thing is going on here.
Well, you know.
I'd love to read one or two of those. I've just finished hearing Jane Eyre from my accent in this book.
Just lift your belt a little higher. I think that will work.
That might be helpful.
That works.
The whole of the 1830 life is shot against blue screen. And you can, I've gone in and out of doors which are just photographs. And you press a button and you suddenly see your scene with in a beautiful castle and in a beautiful, beautiful room.
Yeah.
It's true, might as well do tech checks while there's time.
Yeah.
I like Seth.
Bill, I'm going to move into the mark, so if I do it wrong, hold on a second. Yeah, thank you. All right?
Yes, Karen, I agree. Thank you.
Here it is, it's right there. Can you have that
I believe we're ready.
Okay. Well, what do you call it? This invention of yours.
The analytic engine.
Oh. Tell me, Mr. Babbage. If I'm putting the question wrong, what do the answer comes
to do? Well, that would depend.
Oh, it's all very pretty, but what good is it? I mean, the abacus takes up so much this room and does exactly the same thing.
Very good.
So Stephen said, I hate this music, it's too sweet. And I, what do you think? I said, I think it's great. It's a woman's story, it is a sweet story, it is a sad story. Mm. You know, he uses it and he still can't stand it. So he's going to take it out. He's going to change it even now, after he's entered it into several festivals. Because that's how directors are, that's my lesson. They know what they know, and you can't.
Yeah.
They'll always return to it.
Mm. There'll be like one or two shots that everybody talked you into were okay,
right.
And they still bother you.
That's right.
That's
yeah.
What someone go, oh shit, why am I listening to?
Right. You know, and what never leaves. It never gets any better.
Uh-uh.
Because you know what's right.
Mm-hmm.
And you're not paying attention to yourself.
Right.
That's the way it is.
Yeah.
That's my lesson. If you know, and what happens, a lot of people are soft and they're gentle, and you they need someone to say, do it your way.
Life is inadvertent, and I love the inadvertency of life. And in order to, let's say, imitate life, you have to imitate its inadvertency. And in order to imitate its inadvertency, you have to prepare yourself in such a way that you are inadvertent.
If you already have your speech patterns, you don't have to think about them. If you already have your body patterns mocked up to such a point that you don't have to think about them, if you already have what everybody is to you, you don't have to think about how you look at them or talk to them. And if you have, let's say, flow lines or space pushes and pulls and all this sort of thing, you're doing all this work that you don't think about how am I saying this line, because that's death and it's very, very bad art. I don't know much about method acting, but I did go to visit Strasberg's class once, and I was mortified. People were falling asleep on stage. I don't know what, I mean, I think an actor's fairly busy. You know, he's mocking up, as I say, this. He has this universe, he has this problem, he's thinking about how to get what he needs out of the life he's created for himself. You know, he's so much to do. And were he to just do that, he would be relaxed, because he's got his attention on all these things. He doesn't have to be able to go to sleep on stage. And everyone was so incredibly self-conscious. They were going, do I believe me? They were all doing, no matter what scene they were doing, they were on stage going, do I believe me? Do I believe me? Let's see, if I throw up, I'll believe me. Nonsense! Nothing to do with it. Let me tell you something. No one walking the planet says to himself, do I believe me? Not one person is sitting out there saying, do I believe me? So why are you incorporating into your acting technique? You're only going to harm yourself. It can't be good for you. And anyhow, I thought it was very silly. Then I'm there in front of Strasberg, and he says, put your mascara on. So I'm putting my imaginary mascara on. After all, he says, you didn't look at yourself in the mirror, and that tells me something. What did he tell you? What did he tell you? Well, I will tell you later. What is he, a sphinx? What is he, like, you know, a pyramid? He's a teacher. Tell me what the hell you're talking about. Otherwise, you're belittling me, aren't you? I haven't been very smart about people. So, it isn't, the hardships are lurking there, and you do have to, as an actor, take care of yourself. I would, like, get married and go home. I wouldn't call anyone up for a year. I'd make a phone call. I was raising a baby, you see. Or I would wait for someone to ask me to do a movie, and it would be a stranger from Brazil, it would be a stranger from London, somebody, and then I would do the best I could, and then we'd start running out of huge amounts of money, and then it was just stupid. It's actually the exact definition and manifestation of the word stupid: unknowingness of time, place, form, and event. Where was I? You are in Hollywood, Karen. You're not in Illinois. You can't just go home and raise a kid and never get on the phone. I had a crush on Jack Nicholson. Yeah, I did. Yeah, I really had a crush on him at that time, making Five Easy Pieces. But I had a boyfriend, and he wasn't interested in me. He liked very thin girls. Very, very thin. And I have never been very, very thin. Jack is a great being. He's a really great being. We were doing Five Easy Pieces, I said to him one time, you know, Jack, some people just aren't there. They're just not in their heads. There's just no one home. No matter how you, I'm sick of it, I'm not, you know. He said, Blackie, they're always there. You're always going to find the person there in the middle. Keep looking, and you're going to find him. He has a high regard for his fellow man. And he also has a tremendous including nature. Some people, when there's danger or difficulty, will escape. Some will fight. And some will just reach out their hands and shake the hand of the enemy. And that's Jack.
My son is drowning in the ocean. Drowning, truly drowning, dying. And this wonderful lad, Brian, he's going to save my son. And so he's going out there, and I'm screaming and crying, hysterical. And the camera, but suddenly finds these beautiful half-nude women playing volleyball. And so the camera kind of, you know, stays with them and kind of follows their bodies around and kind of forgets these dying people with this big tragedy on the beach. It's called Babe Watch.
Israel was amazing today. She did a really good job. She did a good Academy Award.
Yeah, really good. The best peep scene in the world. Yeah.
And here she is, Karen. I've been talking about you on the camera.
You look like you would be this.
Really? I don't look Italian.
No, you look like you would be a kind of a bouncy, happy, cheerful, smart guy.
Right.
And so then that's what I thought. So now you look like this, but only a personality, because I don't know what you look like as a person.
I know, you told me from the phone. You thought I was short, fat. Everybody's talked to me on the phone, I was short, fat.
Well, your name is Vince. So you get a lot of associative images of Vince.
Right.
Play act, you know that. Freaking out.
You're gonna have to be careful because they're gonna be yelling.
No, no, Michael promised me we were gonna get levels.
Probably scream like that!
Yeah. Where is he? There you go.
Here we go.
We're gonna shoot the rehearsal.
Okay, let's go.
Everybody know what to do?
No.
There's not a lot written down.
Not yet.
Not yet. We're trying.
So you really want to put down this is mom.
Is it okay? You're cold and freezing.
Water to see him.
Cold and freezing.
Then you're gonna say here, you know, back off. Whatever you see up there, and then you're gonna go and pour it.
Oh, he's all cold.
And meanwhile, she's moaning and crying about her son at that point.
Here we go. Okay, bud.
Check
out the shiny board.
Okay.
Vince, let's give the girls back there a little bit more elaborate workings to do.
Hi, I'm Rebecca Cheney, and I'm related to Lon Cheney, who is deceased, but Lon Cheney Jr., Colin Clive, fifth cousins, and our family moved to Texas, so I came here to be an up-and-coming Cheney. I am a Cheney.
When the camera hits them, that's when they do more interesting stuff. And I'll tell you when the camera hits them, I'll go like that. Okay? I'll go like that. Action!
Here's a video! Oh my God! Oh my God!
You're
oh my God!
Don't call 911! We're almost done! Excuse me, I gotta get a
message!
Excuse me, ma'am, I need to back
up! Ma'am,
call 911! Call 911! Ma'am, please stay away! Someone call 911!
Shut up!
Cut! That was excellent.
For me?
Yes.
I'm kind of in love with my mother. I certainly like her as well or better than anyone else on Earth.
Mother.
We get along so well. She restores me. I can go there very exhausted and out of sorts. And in 2 days after the visit, I'm just feeling so happy and so wonderful and glorious.
This is Mother, you are my favorite person in the whole world. You are a Stradivarius of a woman. I'm a woman. Oh, thank you, Sharon.
I can describe you to others, too.
I was so relieved.
Uh-huh.
And comfortable. Not
that.
That. Should get my glasses off.
No. If you had your glasses, you couldn't read that either. Nobody can read my writing.
That you are my mother, this life.
Yeah.
I want you to continue to be as you are, all my love.
She's an award-winning novelist. She's written short stories that have been sold all over the country, different magazines and so forth. And we just love each other so much. And I call her all the time and keep up with everything.
Makes you perfect because you're a redhead. What a rampant up. Do you want to wear it? Let me see that one.
I guess nobody ever expected that you would be such a big success. Because you just weren't the kind of group aggressive or anything, or ambitious. I remember how a beautiful voice you had, you know, when we had, you were taking ballet lessons and she wanted you to be Cinderella in this little play. And how old were you then, 11 years old or so?
Sounds way too old.
So you must have been 8 or 9 then, but okay. You were 7. And she wanted you to do this part and do this little singing thing. And so we took you to a teacher to have you give a few lessons. And she said you had a perfect pitch and you had a beautiful voice. You know?
Uh-huh.
And I remember when you sang your little song on the stage and I was in the wings watching. And it was so beautiful. You know, just, and there was something about the way you did it. I was watching the audience and they were just enthralled. Like I said, this kid has something. But anyway, you showed your talent early.
What I think is the most interesting out of all of this is how no one expected that I would be smart and no one expected that I would be able to sing.
Right.
No one expected that I would ever, you know, really be successful in movies because I was a quiet person.
Right.
I noticed that there's a certain kind of chutzpah.
Kind of what?
Verb and ruthlessness and ambition that I've seen in Bette Midler, seen in her.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. One time she found I could sing and fear passed over her face.
Really?
Yeah. No, it's not rational. Mm-hmm. And I believe that Goldie Hawn has that. Mm-hmm. And there, it's just some kind of a...
Joan Crawford had it.
Yeah? Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, it's a certain thing that I think I do lack. I do lack it. And I'm a cheap date in life, you know. I'm really happy. Agatha Christie once said, successful people are people who are not happy unless they're successful. They're not happy. If you can get them happy before they're really successful, they're not going to make it in that way. And I have to say, I think it describes me. I'm a cheap date in life. I'm happy already. I'm pretty happy.
Well, your nature is separated from your career. You're the kind of person who enjoys every moment.
I remember her of many, many movies I saw in Russia, and many Russians remember her and beautiful face, beautiful acting in the movie. I love her. She's so great. And many others, Hitchcock and other movies. And she performed, in our movie, she performed greatest part. And I've just have very great respect for her. Actually, I love her.
Doing this movie for a wonderful man, darling Russian man, his name is Rodion the Hapatov. And so I'm going to complain now. Just because it's information I don't think very many people ever hear about what it's like to make a movie. I have a very nice room, and that's swell. Now, but I worry about the making of the movie. I have concerns about it. I want it to go well. Why? Because I'm part of the group, so I want their purposes to be fulfilled. I want it to be good. So I keep thinking how they could be doing something better than what they're doing. For example, why don't they phone me and say, we're ready for you on the set? Because when they send someone all the way from the other floor down the elevator to get, they lose 5 minutes. See? They could be doing that. And then also, all actors have this problem on almost all movies. They say, we're ready for you. Well, an actor is not a doll or a mannequin. An actor eats a grape and they lose some of their lipstick. They sweat and their powder is gone. My hair, it gets curlier every 10 minutes. It frizzes and frizzes and frizzes. So if they would say, we'll need you in 10 minutes, come in 10 minutes, hello Karen, be here in 10 minutes already, they would save 15 minutes. The 10 minutes that it takes me to get ready, and every actor, and especially every actress, to get ready to be on camera, and the 5 minutes it takes for someone to patter down here and knock on my door and ask me. So that kind of thing, you know, I notice.
And that's a universal thing.
That happens on every picture. There's no prediction. There's just no one will predict for the performer. They won't say, we'll probably need, unless you ask. They will sometimes tell you, we'll need you, but generally you got to ask. And if you don't ask, you can sit there and wait for the next shot for a half an hour, and nobody tells you, oh, we won't need you for an hour and a half. You can go to your room. So that's another complaint. But this is a universal complaint. All actors are talking. Then the other thing is, generally people will allow me after 25 years to do my own makeup because I know how to, you know, even in this little film, you know, I've been seen with no eyes at all when I didn't draw them on yet. Now I have these big glamorous eyes. I kind of know how to glue them on and glue them up and make all these drawings around my eyes. But when they know you're going to do your own makeup, come with me. They know you're going to do your own makeup. They don't look at you. You could have like schmata here. You know, they don't say, oh, and by the way, your mascara came down to here. I can't see my face. Talk to me. Here, let's do this.
Hello. Well, I should be walking this way then, shouldn't I? We're
much
not
better.
5 minutes away. Is that
oh
good for you?
Oh, my God. Very good.
We're
congratulations.
Moving really fast. Well, thank you.
Okay. So I'll just
lovely. It's a
do my potato hanahona. I'll be there.
Potato hanahona and see you downstairs.
Okay,
five.
Good.
Thank you.
Okay, bye. I stand corrected. They did exactly what I said they don't do. You got to cut this part of the film.
Working with her, and especially in her close eye, she performs so many difficult changes, some smile and angriness and everything. It's so great.
Here we go. And shh. Action.
She was very professional. She's very simple. She's very accurate. She always prepare for what she's doing. She's not like, I don't know what to do. She knows what to do. Always, each moment of her existence on the screen, she's different. She's happy and she's has something else inside and she covers this. She's a great actress, it's no doubt.
Here we go. And shh. Action.
She was very professional. She's very simple. She's very accurate. She always prepare for what she's doing. She's not like, I don't know what to do. She knows what to do. Always, each moment of her existence on the screen, she's different. She's happy and she's... has something else inside, and she covers this. She's a great actress, it's no doubt.
Cut.
Set on the room.
And we're cut. Good.
And can you do this? Earlier?
What do you feel?
Leaning the chair back.
Yeah.
Yes, of course.
A little bit earlier.
Right. Do you miss your father a lot, don't you?
Yes.
That's when he should pull the chair.
Right. This is a speed.
Yeah.
This is a speed.
Great.
This is a speed. Great. Yeah. This is a speed.
Okay.
Nice.
Beautiful, Rodion. This is beautiful. Wonderful. You created a wonderful thing.
Can you help me just put this?
You're not? Okay. You need to move the other side?
You lost my mirror. I have a new mirror. I'll be all right.
The character in Modern Rhapsody as written was lofty and had all the answers. And I simply hated that notion because I just don't think anyone has all the answers. Anyone who does have answers doesn't run around thinking they have all the answers, or they're kind of snotty, really. And I met the character, the woman, actually, in the Yucatan, that the character was written after. What I did was I made her just very loving and very light and very playful. And I took the onus off that wisdom, because wisdom really, if you have wisdom, you're happy. And if you don't, you're sad and unhappy. And so I thought that she would be happy.
That's great.
Donya only loves two types of women, foreign and domestic.
The DP was Mario Garcia, but he had translucent skin and I always wanted to kiss him on the cheeks and hug him, and he was very beautiful. And he would wait for the sun, set mirrors around the room, he'd wait for the sun to come at an angle through the window, and then the light would be reflected around the room in the most glorious way.
Suelo, look!
He was very brilliant.
You guys are going to cringe up and around. You want to know what's going on?
Can I have Bobby Peter and Rhodes, please? I need a short verse.
Yeah.
I just screamed in your ear. I apologize. Thank you. Careful the edge of the pool. I just don't want you to fall in. The preacher is going to be leading Sissy away. As he's leading Sissy away, you guys are going to cringe. Up and around. You
want to
know what's going on?
Yeah, just yeah, on the spit.
I'm the leader of the cult, and I'm incredibly into this believing thing. And we also take lots of blue droplets of things, so I'm really drugged all the time. That's the real reason for my behavior. But and I sing everything, and I'm sort of like, I guess, out of my mind.
Maybe I need you now.
Okay.
Karen's a special lady. She's takes everything in, you know, everything around her and all the people around her. She doesn't miss a thing. She takes it all in and then gives it back to you.
I was in Florida. I was making a movie. I was pretty much making it for money. And I liked it that let me be pretty, because often they made me not pretty at all in movies. And the costume person came, but she was the producer's wife, and she had no costume schedule. So it was my responsibility to call the AD to find all the numbers of the scenes. Yeah?
Request it on set, please.
Okay, thanks. I can talk as we go, though.
Love it. If you stayed for the coverage of the preacher so that we could have off-camera lines for him.
Okay.
Yes. That'd be great. So that's what we're going to do next.
Okay.
She's very beautiful.
I want to go home. I'm so tired. I'm going to go to sleep.
I'm feeling tired.
I have a lovely, lovely girl coming over to pack me tonight. Oh, you can't pack.
You're going away.
Can you scramble eggs?
I have to say, Jerry, that the character in The Hunger,
darling,
just appeared.
Well, can you? Light cooking. I like scrambled eggs. I like them a lot. Jerry, have you met Steph?
When I wasn't working, I went to the location and sat in the wheelchair and rode around a lot so I could be sure to do that properly.
Well, Jerry, what do you think? Isn't she charming?
I don't know what happened. I just read it, and I just happened.
Look at me. Do I look as though I have a headache? I'll wait for my morphine. Thank you very much.
It was directed by Ridley Scott's son, Jake. And I think, you know, that his sensibility about place is shades of his father, Ridley. The surgery where I would get my shots,
don't tease,
was so white it was like, you know, thought you were looking at black and white film.
There is no dignity in decay. The body, you know, has an uncanny ability to compensate for its own deficiencies.
I see her like this because she's went to Berkeley and she's a blind psychiatrist, so what she would do is just wash and wear hair just like that, and I think that'll work really good. And I think this is a good look for a gay blind psychiatrist. So what, you want to try the other wig?
Yeah. Okay. But I think that this, and we want to use normal hair anyway. So
okay.
Probably better.
So you like this better right now? You think that's probably better?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think you hold it too. Yeah.
I know I do.
And then I pull it down.
That's interesting.
Can I brush it? That's interesting too, though. You look pretty sexy.
And it looks like the receptionist?
Let's see. That's just me. See?
That's that part in the middle.
Yeah. You do it how you want. See, that's pretty beautiful.
Better than I thought.
Yeah, you look sexy. And she is so... I think it's great. That is so different.
Oh my God.
Isn't that good?
Yeah, it's really good.
You know, she talks like this.
Yes, she does.
What are you laughing at, dear? She does that, so she talks.
I like that a lot better.
She looks like a meanie.
She does.
That's what she is. Okay.
Yay!
I studied and watched blind people for 2 days. One was at the Braille Institute, and one was at this coffee mornings that they have in Glendale.
No, I'm not smiling. Can I have another one as a kiss just to make sure I have the exposure right?
Oh, no, I don't want to just do anything as
keep your still pajamas on,
as slavish as that, but see, I got a laugh. I got a laugh out of it.
Thank you.
Enough already.
How many did you get?
Thank you.
George, you meant it. That's great.
I'm what?
He's like a disturbed guy.
And that was fabulous.
That was great.
Roll sound.
Rolling.
Hey.
Action.
Blind people
make
very swift, certain. Swerves of the head to talk to the person to their right, to their left.
You smell very sweet, Stan.
Completely very missing sweet. Where the person really is sitting.
Thanks.
But with every certainty. And they talk right over there to the person's shoulder,
hi,
behind the person's
there.
Head.
My name is Callie.
Alex. Oh, you can shake it harder than
it's
that.
It's all what it is, you know. It isn't anything I don't think that one can suppose. You have to go witness it.
Oh, you're a lovely girl.
Hi. Stephen is, he's very, very handsome. He's one of the most handsome men I've ever seen. And I really think he's one of the most handsome men anyone has ever seen. I don't know why he's in love with me, but he seems to be in love with me. And he's really a very huge heart. He is a hunk. He is an angel hunk.
I got there 2 minutes before the deadline. Come back, Stephen.
He's
just getting food. He can't wait. He is a darling. He's an angel. I spent some time with his brother, and he's a very, very handsome, and he's an angel and a very good, beautiful soul, the way that my husband is. And so every once in a while I get this crush, and I say to Stephen, Stephen, I'm in love with your brother. And if he comes to the door, I'm afraid I'll have to go away with him. And Stephen says, yeah, you know, all the women feel that way. But I saw him a lot in San Francisco. It was very good for me to do a nightly performance. And my exact goal is that people go home with something that they can look back on in their memory and never forget. You know, because it's just so open. I'm so open. I really cry. Everybody cries. There was a lady who came, you know, people come back to the shows. One lady came back and she kept hugging me and sticking her face on my face.
And it's okay because during the show they feel close to me, and then it continues when the show is over. The differentiation between social and aesthetic sometimes does not become reinstated.
What's like? You know, it's like my character work. Will the real Karen Black please stand up? And I think that in some ways, it's a trick.